So in the first four lectures on pipelining, we had discussed this basic five-stage pipeline, and we had discussed, you know, what happens in each and every single stage. And we had assumed ideal conditions, right? So we said that instruction I1 starts out in cycle 1, instruction I2 starts in cycle 2, I3 starts in cycle 3, and so on. And we'd assumed that each instruction finishes 5 cycles later. So in cycle 5, instruction 1 finishes and leaves the pipeline. Instruction 2 finishes in cycle 6, and so on. And that gives me a perfect IPC of 1. Right? Every single cycle, I'm able to graduate or complete one new instruction, and that gives me this perfect IPC of 1. But most pipelines are usually not perfect. They're not ideal like this. They usually have hazards or bubbles that are introduced in the pipeline. And that's what we're going to discuss next. Okay, so there are three kinds of hazards. The first is called a structural hazard, and it usually happens when multiple instructions are competing for the same resource. The second hazard is a data hazard, where one instruction is waiting for a previous instruction to produce a result that it itself needs. Okay, and when that happens, the second instruction is forced to wait. The third example of a hazard is when you encounter a branch and you don't quite know where to go next, right? So this is actually a special example or a special case of a data hazard where, you know, one instruction needs to figure out where to go. And in order to figure that out, you need a result from a previous instruction. Okay, but, you know, since control hazards are handled very differently, they have their own separate category. Okay, so now we'll go through some examples of structural hazards, data hazards, and control hazards. I'll spend this video on structural hazards. Next video, I'll focus on data hazards and also introduce the concept of forwarding, also called bypassing. And then when I discuss control hazards, I'll introduce the concepts of a branch delay slot. And in a much later video, I'll also introduce the concept of branch prediction. But first, let's start by looking at what a structural hazard is. Okay, so if I again go back to this example over here. So if you look at our pipeline, in this case, if I make the assumption that there is a unified memory structure that has, you know, both instructions and data, that now possibly leads to a structural hazard, and let's see how. Okay, so let's just look at what happens in cycle 4. In cycle 4, instruction 1 is going to access the data memory. Okay, we have a single unified memory structure that stores both instructions and data, and I'm now currently going to look up this single memory structure. At the same time, here is instruction 4 that is trying to look up the instruction memory. And again, since I have a single structure that has both instructions and data, here's an example where two different instructions, I1 and I4, are both competing for that same single resource in the same cycle, in cycle CC4. Okay, so when this happens, I can only let one of these instructions proceed, and the other one has to wait. Okay, so I've made the assumption that there's only a single structure that has instructions and data, and there's only a single access port, which means only one can proceed in any given cycle. Okay, so when this happens, you know, I had issued I1 in cycle 1, I2 in cycle 2, I3 began over here. Now suddenly I4 cannot proceed. It has to give precedence to I1. Okay, so I say, all right, what's going to happen in this cycle is a pipeline bubble. Something essentially just goes through the pipeline doing nothing, accessing nothing. And instead, I'll try to issue I4 in this next cycle, in cycle 5. But again, I have the same problem because I2 is accessing the data memory. So this will also be a pipeline bubble that'll end up going through the pipeline. I try showing I4 over here. I'm going to compete with I3's access for the data memory. Again, all that I can do is a bubble. Then in the next cycle, I try issuing I4. This is now, you know, up to cycle 7. And at this point, there is no competition because the instruction accessing data memory at this point is this pipeline bubble, right? So it is this bubble that moves into the stage. It's really not accessing data memory. So now my unified memory structure is free to service other instructions. So now I can actually do the instruction memory access for I4, and I4 now proceeds. right? So I issued three instructions, I1, I2, I3. Then I issued a pipeline bubble over here, a pipeline bubble over here, a pipeline bubble over here. And then finally, in cycle 7, I was able to proceed, right? So because of this competition for resources, my perfect IPC of 1 has gone to an IPC of 0.5. Because what I'm doing is every 6 cycles, I'm issuing 3 useful instructions, and then I'm issuing 3 pipeline bubbles, which are really doing nothing, right? So if you look at how instructions are leaving the pipeline, you know, you'll have 3 instructions leaving back-to-back, then you have 3 pipeline bubbles, then again you go back to issuing, you know, 3 instructions back-to-back, then 3 more pipeline bubbles, and so on. So on average, an instruction leaves the pipeline only every other cycle. Right, so because of these structural hazards, my IPC has gone down to 0.5. And that's why, you know, hazards are bad. That's why we don't like hazards. And in this case, the hazard came about because I had this under-provisioned pipeline. I had the single unified memory structure with just a single access port. And there are different instructions that are trying to access the same structure in different cycles or in different stages. Okay, and so the best way to deal with these structural hazards is to throw more resources at the problem, or throw more hardware at the problem. So what I should instead be doing is having, you know, 2 separate structures. One that has the instruction memories, or one that stores all the instructions, and one that stores all the data. And in cycle 4, instruction 1 would then access this data memory structure, this one over here. And in the same cycle 4, I4 would access this instruction memory structure. They're completely different structures. Each has their own access port. And this is how you avoid this contention for the same resource. Okay. One other example of a structural hazard would be with register file access. Right. So let's look at cycle 5 over here. This is where I do my register write for instruction I1. And at the same time, for instruction I4, I'm doing my register read over here. If I had just, you know, I mean, I always have just one single register file, but if I had only one access port, then trying to do the read and the write at the same time would be a problem, right? So what I need to do is have separate read ports and separate write ports, and that allows I1 to proceed with its write in cycle 5, right over here, and allows I4 to proceed with its read in the same cycle 5. In this example 5-stage pipeline that we had seen, recall that we had this aggressive assumption that a write could finish in half a cycle and a read could finish in half a cycle, right? So in that case, we were further avoiding contention by making sure that the writes happen in the first half and the reads happen in the second half, right? But that was an aggressive assumption. Usually the write takes up the entire cycle and the read takes up the entire cycle. And the way to avoid contention for the register file is to make sure that you have separate write ports and separate read ports. Right, so again, by adding more ports, we've made sure that a structural hazard does not exist, and we can have, you know, instruction I1 and I4 proceeding at the same time. Okay, so that's what I've summarized in this slide, and I've given an example where a unified instruction and data cache, or a unified instruction and data memory, if you had implemented that, then you would have competition for resources, and that leads to stalls. But they're easy to eliminate. You throw more hardware at the problem, and you're able to remove this competition for resources. So in the next video, I'll look at data dependencies and data hazards and how they can possibly be alleviated by doing forwarding or bypassing.